So hi everyone, good evening. I'm Karan and Yogita is also here on the session. Both of us are from Green Essentials and we'll be conducting the session thanks to the support that we have from HasGeek, who makes all the technology very easy for us in this situation. I'm glad that you could join us. For those of you who are joining us after the previous session, welcome back. And for those of you who are perhaps joining for the first time, we're glad to have you here. I'd just like to point out that the past sessions are available online. So if you would like to see them, just let us know and we'll share with you the link where these are accessible. Now this session, I think, should be very interesting because a lot of you in the previous ones mentioned that you would like to know more about managing plant health and dealing with pests and disease. So that's really going to be the centerpiece of what we talk about today. This is part four of a five-part series that we've planned. Basically, we hope to have the next session on the coming Thursday. That is next weekend, next week, and that will be the last in this series. So coming to really what we want to cover today, I'll start with a little bit of a background for the benefit of the new people who've joined today. We started Green Essentials because Yogita basically started growing a lot of our vegetables at home, and we felt this was something we could share with people. So we started growing in around 2006, and basically Green Essentials is also an organic kitchen garden store in Goa. That's where we have been located for the last 20 years ourselves. We've been doing the workshops on growing food for about 10 years. And along the way, we've also been doing a fair bit of growing of vegetables, basically because at a larger scale, at the farm scale. Now, what we really aim to do, other than, of course, running the store, is to make it easier for people to grow their own food, right? So that's really the main goal that we have with what we do and with these workshops too. So what is this whole thing about growing food about? We have talked in the past of it being about food security, for instance, where, you know, in recent times, because of the lockdown, many of us may have found access to fresh vegetables difficult to find. So that is one aspect of why you should even take the time or the effort to grow your own food. Another aspect which we feel is, you know, way, way underappreciated is just the difference in terms of taste and flavor, right? So everything that you will eat that is grown in your own garden will taste significantly different from what you've been getting from the market. And the primary reason for that is because it is way fresher. Yeah, so food freshness really matters. And what you're seeing on the screen right now in front of you is an example of the extent to which it matters. So you will see that on the left side, we have a bunch of palak that we bought for the market. And which was stored in the fridge, which in theory should keep it, you know, fresher. And on the right side is some spinach or palak, which has been harvested from our garden. And it was stored not in the fridge, but just in a basket covered with a wet cloth in the kitchen. Now, if you just look at the two, the difference is just incredible, right? So the homegrown produce stays way fresher and is much more delicious when one gets around to kind of eating it, right? So that's really the focus of why we feel we should grow. And of course, this flavor also leads on into nutrition. The food is just way more nutritious because it is fresher, right? So these, I would say, are the key benefits of us wanting to grow organic food at home. Now, just as a recap, in session three, we talked a lot about which seedlings can be grown, sown in groups or singly. We talked about individual seedlings being easier to transplant because you didn't have to separate, you know, plants together. There was less damage to the roots. We suggested that, you know, the time to transplant is between 21 to 25 day old seedlings from the day that you sow. And at this stage, usually there are between 4 to 6 true leaves on the plant, right? And the plant is usually, say, about 3 inches or a little bit more in height. The requirements of the plants determine of different plants are different, and therefore, you decide what can be planted together in a pot based on these requirements. And lastly, we had actually covered microgreens and shown how they can be easily grown in places even where you have very low light. Okay, so coming back to this sort of sequence we've been following right from the beginning of the sessions, we are now at the stage where we want to cover growing and caring, and this is more or less the most important stage of growth that you can experience, right? So this is the longest stage in a sense, because your plants may be in this growing phase from anything from, like, say, 4 weeks to even as much as 3 months, depending on which plant it is. And this is the period in which we have to take the most care in terms of being observant, seeing what problems occur, and then intervening, to ensure that their health is good. Today's session, here's what we plan to cover. The first thing we want to talk about is creating the right environment for the plants to thrive. So vegetables, of course, as we all know, take a little more effort to grow, and we want to make sure that the environment is conducive for them. What do you do to keep your plants happy and healthy? What are the interventions you can make? That's another area that we'll talk about. To our mind, this is the most important stage of, aspect of being a gardener, figuring out what you need to do to keep your plants happy and healthy. And this is the one which deserves most of your time and effort. The next thing we talk about is, of course, identifying problems that may be occurring with the health of your plants, and finding solutions for them that are organic, especially for the most common pest problems that you're likely to experience, right? So, before I go ahead, I'd just like to remind you that you can actually send in your questions to us. If you are viewing this on YouTube, you can add in a comment, and the folks from HazGeek will kind of make sure that comes up for answering when we reach the Q&A section at the end. You should enter your questions into the Q&A section of your Zoom's interface. So if you look at the bottom of your Zoom interface, there are these two speech bubbles, and they've got Q&A written on them. Click on that and you can enter your question in there. It would just be easier for us to view the questions and make sure they are addressed. Please, you can do this right through the session as we go through it, or you can do this at the end, but please do that, so that any doubts can be clarified. Now coming to the actual growing stage, and here is what we believe are some of the common mistakes that new gardeners make, and we'd like to share them so that you can sort of make sure that you avoid these particular mistakes. There's nothing wrong with it if you have made them. These are the same mistakes we made in the early days of our growing, so let's hope that you can avoid them from now, and we are convinced that these will lead to better results. So planting too much of one thing is a very common mistake that people make. As an example, for example, there was a friend and they decided that they wanted to plant 20 pots of ladyfinger. Now they ended up having a lot of ladyfinger, but not much else. And that's not something that you really want to have. The other mistake that everyone makes, and even more so if you've got a gardener doing it for you, is overwatering of the plants, which happens literally, what you know, to such an extent that more or less people seem to be watering those plants to death, and people will see the leaves being shriveled and think that they need more water, whereas what they actually need is less water. So it's an easy mistake to make. Now, the other thing that we notice is people start growing, because they are so eager to get things sown, they start growing in very poor or depleted soils. So they don't take a lot of care about their soil before they sow. They actually then, look at the performance of the plant and then decide that, oh, it's not doing very well, let me do something about my soil. So that we believe is a mistake. You need to fix your soil and address your soil before you even start sowing your seeds. Then people frequently forget to plan their succession crops. which means that they will start growing something, enjoy the produce, be very happy, and suddenly realize that the garden has run out of things to eat. And that's because they didn't plan their next round of growing, right? And of course, the last thing is growing things in the wrong season. This is very, very common. We run an online seed store, and I frequently am perplexed by the seeds that people are buying at a certain point of time. For example, we are in summer now in most parts of India. It's getting warmer, and you will have people wanting to grow cabbage, cauliflower, broccoli, things that do well only in the cool season. So, seasons is another aspect to kind of look into and pay attention to. Now, most of us are going to be growing in containers. There may be some of us who have our own gardens and are actually growing in the ground. But if most of us are living in urban spaces, we, have an apartment. And what we would like to remind you, if you've not, done this before, is that growing in containers can be very, very productive. What you're seeing here is like a half pipe that is used for water harvesting very commonly. And you can just fill soil into it, and shallow-rooted leafy vegetables can really thrive even in these conditions. So imagine this across, along your balcony railing. I'm sorry, as a place where, you can get really good supply of leafy greens at any point in time. Now, what are the principles that we want to follow for growing? And we believe that starting with the principles is a very good thing, because, eventually most of us have lost touch a little bit with how nature works or how plants work. So when you get down to growing for the first time, it requires a little bit of re-engagement mentally, or of, remembering things that we've forgotten. Most of us have probably touched upon it last in school. So here are some principles of natural farming, which also translate to growing, even if it's in pots in your terrace, on your terrace, or in your balcony, right? The first rule is that if we are trying to move away and from pesticides, we are trying to go move away from chemical growing systems, then what we need to do is we need to learn how to mimic great nature in whatever our growing space is. There is a certain sort of set of processes and principles by which nature operates. And if we can reproduce these in our gardens or in our terrace, container gardens, then growing becomes much easier for us, right? And by this, we mean that, okay, you need to think about how nature nourishes soil, and you can try and ensure that you replicate that in your garden also. So one of the things that we do is we improve soil texture. Quite often, if you pick up your soil from a nursery, it will be red, clayey soil. While that is good soil, it needs to be changed a little bit in order to grow vegetables, especially, right? So we will incorporate organic matter in the form of coco peat or coco soil into this clayey soil. So you may recall in the last session we talked about 50, 25, 25 as being the proportions, 50% what soil you have, 25% of vermicompost, and 25% of coco soil or coco peat. And that gets you to the almost, ideal point in terms of the soil needed to grow your vegetables. Now, of course, in addition to vermicompost, which I mentioned, you could also try out cow dung. It's a good substitute if it is available to you. That's another good one to try out. And we also suggest, and this is limited to gardens, not so much to container gardens, but to gardens in the ground, you can include cycles of green manuring, which is a process by which you grow certain plants with the goal of improving the soil through that growing process and not really trying to harvest, right? So if there are folks who are growing in the gardens or on a larger space like a farm, drop us a message on Telegram and we'll be able to, give you a more detailed note on green manuring. Now, the soil biology is something that is worth, most of us understanding, because there are many more things at play than we really, imagine. Now, if you look at this thing, this is by the FAO, and it talks about soil being the foundation of nutrition. So if you want nutrient-rich, produce from your kitchen garden, then you want to take care to make sure that you are simulating many of the processes that nature uses to ensure that good nutrients get into the plants, right? So there are a lot of soil micronutrients and micronutrients which come into play. And you know, creating healthy soil will ensure that all of these are present also. And if you'll see over here, it talks about taking steps like keeping the soil surface covered to reduce erosion. It also talks about crop rotations, subjects that come into play when we are trying to grow in container gardens too. So this is, you know, a document that is available. Again, something we can send you a link to. It'll be put down in the resources folder, which is accessible to you after the session. One big step that we've mentioned to you is really the process of utilizing mulch. And if you, you know, think about it, some of the most fertile soils that you and I will experience are actually in forests. For those of us who like to take a trek or have been to a sanctuary or walked through a forest, you will remember feeling the soft springy layer of leaf below you. Now this leaf litter or mulch is what leads to the forest soil being so fertile, because leaves fall from the trees, they are incorporated into the soil. This increases the carbon in the soil, which holds moisture for a much longer period of time, and also transfers micronutrients which are pulled up by the roots of the big trees into the leaves and then dropped back into the soil. So a lot of the cycles of nature really kind of happen as a result of this mulch. And this is something that we want to very happily copy into our growing, right? Now, mulch has four or five very clear benefits, which is why I would say in some senses, it is the most powerful cheat you can use to be actually successful in your garden with less effort. The first thing that it does is, because it becomes this sort of blanket that shades the soil from sunlight and from wind, it holds moisture for a much longer period of time. So you need to water less and your plants can go for long periods of time without additional watering. The second thing it does is it keeps alive very healthy populations of soil microbes, which exist below the mulch, and they act as the sort of chefs of your soil, converting the food and nutrition that's present in it into a form that plants can more easily take up. Earthworms are another agent that work under the mulch also. And it is this entire ecosystem that ends up happening within, which creates living soil, which is really, you know, beneficial for you and makes your life a lot easier. Mulch also eliminates weeds. So you don't have to spend any time weeding, because weeds will just not sprout through this mulch layer, which is at least 2 inch you know, thick, even in a pot, let alone in the garden where we may have it even thicker, right? So in addition to this, the mulch will also reduce your soil temperature, which will reduce the heat stress or the cold stress that your plants will feel. So whether it's winter in a very cold place, say in the hills, putting mulch will warm up the soil and therefore the plants experience less stress. And if it's summer, it keeps the soil cooler than the ambient temperature outside, which again, you know, leads to plants experiencing less stress. So their health is better. So their immunity to pest and disease tends to be higher, right? So the next thing in terms of principles that we would want to copy from nature is diversity. Now, healthy nature has great diversity. And one of the things that tends to happen, you know, in farming or chemical-based farming, large-scale farming, and also in our gardens, is we forget about the diversity principle. We tend to grow only two or three things. And as a result, you know, we have much less resistance to damage due to disease and pests. So if one pest comes in, it will, you know, eliminate more than a third of your produce, because this pest likes that particular thing that you've grown in a larger quantity, and you know, you have poor results. So what we suggest is that ensuring that your garden has diversity, you don't put clumps of the same thing together. You try to space them out and create variety in order to confuse pests and to make sure that you are not affected to a great extent. Even if damage happens because of one pest, it's limited to say, maybe less than 20% of your crop, even 10% of your crop. So if you look at the diagram over here, what we would do is, and while we've drawn beds in this case, this would also apply to any pots we do, we would mix them up. So we would have leafy crops, and then we would have a root vegetable, like say beetroot in the winter season. It doesn't grow in summer. Then we would have a fruiting vegetable, like say tomato, growing next to that. And then a herb crop next to that, say basil or celery. You could have a bean crop in the next bed. And, you know, while you don't have to follow this exactly, the reason that we've showed you the sequence is that if you were to take one representative from each of these families, and you can see the list below each of these, you would end up with enough variety to, you know, make sure that the diversity principle works for you in your garden, right? So that's diversity. Now, this diversity manifests, as I said, in outdoor gardens and also in indoor gardens. This is an example of a farm that we helped set up in Bir in Himachal. Now you'll see there are jamun trees over here. There's sunflower growing. There's bay leaf. There is lettuce, which is flowering in the, you know, on the right side of the screen. Corn growing over here. Brinjals, pumpkin, all of these growing together and sort of mixing up, giving you enough diversity for your plate and also for pest resistance. Now, the same diversity also applies indoors. So if you take the example of this particular garden, you will see we have many things: brinjal, kale, basil, Swiss chard, mustard greens, and beetroot growing in this one garden itself. I think we have a chili plant at the back also. Right. So borage is another thing that we've grown here. So essentially, you will see that this is exactly how you end up arranging it. Even if you're growing in a balcony, you don't, you know, put aside the diversity principle just because your space is different from an outdoor garden. Now, being mindful of the seasons is really, really critical. You know, you may want to grow some things in summer, but if that's not conducive to the plant that you're trying to grow, you're just going to have no results at all. Sometimes things will grow in the, you know, even out of season, but the kind of productivity that you will have or fruiting will just not happen in a, you know, proper way. For example, a cabbage cannot form its head in, you know, in warm weather. They need cool weather to sort of flourish. Now you'll see over here that we have this planting guide for summer. These are things you can plant right now. We've talked about these in the previous session also. And this is shared in the resources folder. Please feel free to download it from there so that you have a better sense of how to do your growing. It also includes a column which talks about how much of different things you should grow. It's just a suggestion on our part. And depending on the space you have and the number of pots you want to have, you can pick and choose from these. Make sure that you have at least 4 or 5 different things growing, because otherwise then, you know, diversity won't really be achieved. Now, soil microbes, which I referred to earlier when we were talking about mulch, are one of the most important sort of contributors to growing food organically. Now, one of the key differences that we have to understand is that when you're growing organically, it is a biological growing system. So all the interventions and connections that and cycles that they have are, you know, in some sense related to the biology of the earth, right? Plant biology, soil biology, things like this. It's very different from a chemical system where urea is providing the nutrition and therefore you don't need nitrogen, for example. Or you're putting in pesticides to deal with the pests. So you don't create resilience in the system itself. So relative to, you know, organic growing, the soils that you have in chemical farming are, you know, very different. Organic growing requires living soils. And other soils don't work. In chemical growing, that's not always the case. Sometimes even poor soils, when amended with urea and with, you know, supported by pesticides, can be productive up for a period of time at least. Now, optimal use of shade and sunlight is something we've discussed also, but I'd like to mention it again. Some plants tolerate shade and heat, and those are more versatile plants. They also give you a lot of freedom in terms of placing them and how you can grow them. Certain other plants are very particular. They need sunlight to grow. And if left in the shade, they will be either not productive at all or will actually, you know, not survive. They will continue to be weak and very unproductive. So we need to keep this in mind when planning for where we put what in a garden, and especially in balconies where you need make sure that the sunnier balconies in your apartment are the ones in which you are attempting to grow these things, right? Vegetables, especially fruiting vegetables, must have at least 4 or 5 years, hours of direct sunlight, as we've spoken about before. And even other vegetables like leafy vegetables, which are okay in semi-shade, still need to have brightness around and still need 2 or 3 hours of sunlight to be directly incident on them, right? Now we'll come to the issue of pests, and I will kind of hand it over to Yogita to cover these, and she will talk a little about how does one deal with, you know, pests in an organic system when you are not allowed to use things like pesticides, things that are unnatural, and therefore, you know, different approaches need to be taken, right? So over to Yogita.
Yeah, hi. You may be wondering that, you know, we've gone almost 25 minutes and not yet gotten to the meat of attacking where and how to address pest and disease problems. But really, the largest part of addressing plant health is following a lot of these principles. And the things that Karan has covered about diversity, about soil health, about, you know, a numerous, it's like several pieces, when they are arranged together, they create an ecology. And that ecology is a self-correcting system in which pests will not be 100% eliminated, but their impact will be minimized. In any natural system, you will find that is healthy and productive, you will find that there are pests, but the plants and the system is able to absorb those shocks or deal with them in a manner that, you know, you can still have productive yielding plants, and they can address pests, diseases, nutrition deficiencies, and that kind of problem. So some of the approaches that we do follow, and I will talk about this in some more detail, but things like diversity, Karan has covered. Trap crops. Now, trap crops are basically decoys, you can say. You need to understand, with most plants, you need to know firstly what the pest is that is affecting your plant. When you use a chemical, it does not matter what the pest is. It's like a carpet bomb. You bomb everything, and the good guys are dead, the bad guys are dead, and your plants are just about surviving, hanging in there, you know. So When you understand who the pest is, then you can have a more targeted and a more nuanced way of addressing the problem. Now, for example, beans attract a lot of aphids. There are other plants also, like onions and things, that can be attracted to aphids. Now, if I want to have a healthy onion crop, I could plant a trap crop of beans next to it, because that is something that aphids prefer, and they are likely to migrate to this particular plant and leave my main crop alone. So trap cropping is like a decoy. It's a commonly followed principle that you know, organic growers use to distract pests. Crop rotation is again something that's really important. The idea of crop rotation is that in our case, in pots, you don't plant the same type of plant in the same pot again and again. For example, if in a pot you've grown tomato and the plant has died out after 4 or 5 months, do not plant tomato or any other plant from that family, which would include brinjal, chili, capsicum, even potatoes. These are all from one family, and you don't plant the same kind of crop, because it will suck the same kind of nutrients out of that, and it will keep the soils depleted. And then, because there will be lack of nutrition, your plants will become more susceptible to pest attacks or diseases. So crop rotation, planting maybe tomatoes now in this season, in the next season perhaps beans, in the season after that a leafy vegetable. These kinds of rotations help keep the soil fresh and don't, you know, continuously take out the same type of nutrition from it. Karan already mentioned the importance of selecting crops that are appropriate for the season. And we have pheromone traps and lures, which I will, as soon as I get to this, I will show you what that is. It's basically used for insects. It attracts the males of the particular kind of insects, and it traps them, and therefore it cuts the cycle of the life cycle of a particular pest, and it reduces the impact on your crop. this really is the essence of controlling or having healthy plants, is that, you know, plants that are not very healthy are just meant by nature not to survive. And pests and diseases, whether it's fungal, bacterial or viral, they are meant to cull these out. It is the natural cycle to eliminate crops or plants that are not healthy. And so they are actually an indicator of a different problem. We often look at a plant that is unhealthy and say, there's something wrong with this and I need to fix this particular plant. But we need to understand, why is this particular pest here? You know, you need to go back a few steps and understand what is the condition in the soil, in your environment, that is making this plant susceptible to attack from a particular pest. So really, that is the bottom line, that, you know, treat pests and diseases as indicators of a larger or a more deeper problem, rather than saying that, okay, here's the problem and what can I, you know, cure it with what spray and what kind of, you know, there are all sorts of pesticides available. That approach is very short term and it doesn't really address the root of the problem. So you can stop the share now. And if you look at my table right here, I've got a bunch of things, the several quivers in my arrow, if you will. I'll start with the sprays. Now, we have touched upon it, but I will reiterate that when you grow food organically, there are several things that you do to prevent the problem from occurring. So prevention is much better than cure. It is cheaper, it is more effective, and it is more long-term. So there are things you do preventively, but once the problem occurs, then there are a few things that are available that you can do to control the problem or to cure the problem. When we grow organically, we try not to reach the point of cure. We try to address as much as we can at the prevention level so that we don't have a lot, because for some fungal, viral sort of problems, there is very little cure stuff available. Cure solutions are not ample. If you've got a problem and, you know, you've reached that point, you just need to let that plant go and start again and understand what's gone wrong and sort of fix it from there. So I have a bunch of things here. I'll start with, say, cow urine. Now, cow urine is a very smelly, very potent kind of a liquid. You always dilute it. You never use it directly. You can put about 100 to 120 ml in 1 liter of water. And because of its strong odor, it does two things. It either repels pests. I mean, if I smelled this, I wouldn't want to go anywhere close by. And imagine pests that have a much stronger sense of smell would really get repelled by this stuff. Or it masks the odor of things that are desirable to the pest. So if something is a sweet, like peas have a very sweet smelling flower, it can mask the odor and the pests will get confused and they can't find it. So preventively, you can, you know, spray this once a month on your plants if they are generally doing well. If you think that there is a bit of a problem, it can be more frequent, once every 15 days. It is quite effective. You can also use... Sorry? Yeah, well, that too. You can also use cow urine as a base to create other kind of sprays, chili, garlic, ginger sprays. A lot of these are things that are available in your kitchen, and we'll share a document with you that has these recipes that you can sort of make at home and use on your plants. There is some use for having a smoker in the family. You can always bum a few cigarettes and empty it in your cow urine and let it sort of steep there overnight. The nicotine from the cigarettes, when sprayed in dilution, actually helps keep a lot of the pests away. And we'll cover some of them, things like aphids, things like white flies. A lot of the sucking pests we find are repelled by a tobacco solution that has been made in cow urine. It's like a double whammy to them. You can also spray things like chili, like I mentioned, chili, garlic, ginger. You make these concoctions. If you're at a farm, you can actually, you know, there's a bunch of weeds that you collect and you sort of soak them overnight and you make sprays out of that. A lot of the weeds actually do have pest repellent qualities also. But again, these are You can either do them preventively, just every 15 days once your crops have gone into the pot, or you can wait and see when the problem occurs, then you can sort of have it. But usually it's late. By the time the problem occurs, you know, there's a lot less that is possible to do. Another thing I have here is something called Panchagavya. This is made from, it smells vile. Actually, not that bad. It smells like a tabela. It's got five products that come from a cow. It's got cow dung, it's got cow urine, which means it also acts as a plant tonic. It's got dahi, it's got ghee, and it's got milk, and a bunch of other things like tender coconut and overripe bananas and all that. And it's fermented. It's basically a microbial liquor. And you add this to your soil in dilution, or you can spray it as a foliar spray on your plants. And it does two things. It acts as a plant tonic, but also because of the smells and because of the microbes that are present in it, it builds the ability of the soil to be more resilient. And it also repels pests through the action of masking odors and of a strong smelling thing. Yeah, it's also like a liquid fertilizer. Then I have something here that actually, they are sticky traps. They are in different colors. You can peel these off. Now, the principle behind these sticky traps is, I have a yellow one here, I have a white one here, and I have a blue one here. Now, what the principle behind this is that different colors attract different pests. So yellow ones would attract the aphids. The white one, blue ones are useful to attract white flies. Different, and there is some overlap, but you basically peel them and you dangle them in your garden at the level of the foliage of the plant, and the pests do get attracted to it, and they will sort of fly at it, and they'll get stuck and they won't be able to go away. So it's a very non-chemical way, and eventually you can dispose this in your garbage bin, but it's a chemical-free way, it's a mechanical way to sort of attract pests and keep them at bay. It also helps tell you what pests are around. Like, there may be things, several things that will get attracted, and you can sort of see and say, okay, it helps you identify what's going on in your garden. And you can make these also. It's really easy. Just take any plastic sheet that is of a similar color, and you can just smear a sticky oil, any vegetable oil, and sort of dangle it there. It becomes sticky in the sun, and it serves the same purpose. So you don't have to buy it. It can be easily made at home as well. Some of the other mechanical things that work is, it's actually really useful, this one. This is a fruit fly trap. Now, the principle behind this is that many insects are attracted to certain mating hormones or pheromones, and a particular insect will be attracted to a particular hormone only, a pheromone only. So you get different pheromone traps. I have one here. They come in packets like these. This one is meant for the entire gourd family, cucumber, karela, bottle gourd, pumpkin, muskmelon. That entire family gets affected by a particular kind of fruit fly. Some of you, if you've tried growing it, you will notice that when the fruit is small, it will puncture the fruit. It will leave a little mark there, and the fruit doesn't really grow because the eggs are laid inside that puncture. And the larvae develop in there, and they consume all the nutrients, and you'll have, you know, misshapen, deformed fruits, or the fruits will just rot and they'll fall off when they're really tiny. So in order to avoid this, you use the lure in this. It looks like a little cylinder like this, and it is you can smell it. It's a very mild smell, but it's covered with this particular pheromone. So the way this works is, there's a little container inside, you plonk it in there, you close the lid, and if you look at this, there are tiny little holes here and here. Now you dangle this in your garden, you could dangle it near the plants of concern or even a little away, and basically these little fruit flies, they enter through these holes and they just won't leave from that same hole. They will try and find some other exit, they'll keep going down, and obviously they won't be able to get out. And you'll find that there's a whole collection of these dead fruit flies there. And once every 15 days, you can sort of empty it out. Now, the thing to remember is that the fruit flies that get in are the male flies. Usually that's what, because this is the mating hormone, it thinks that the females are in there. and a whole bunch of them just keep going in. And once you've taken out all the males from the population, the next generation pest falls drastically. There is no reproduction happening. So that's really one of the most effective things to use in a garden. You also have another kind of fruit fly that affects fruits. If you have fruit trees like chiku, mango, guava, you'll find a similar problem with them. But the lure for that is different. Then there is another trap here. This has got a lure that is as small as this. You sort of put it into this little pin and you stick it at the top over here and you hang it. Now this is used mostly for brinjal. This particular one, it's used for brinjals and it attracts the fruit and shoot borer. You know, if you buy bengan in the market, you'll see that sometimes when you cut it, it's got like a rotten patch inside, or if you've been growing it, you'll find that you know, the fruit has these black marks and they don't seem to grow very well. These are fruit and shoot borers and they completely destroy the brinjals. That's the one that they often target. So if you hang these around, and you know, like something like this, you need 4 to an acre. So if you have a balcony, one of this is more than sufficient. As with this, you can just have them hanging around. It would look rather strange having all these things hanging around, but they are very effective. Then there is something called rock phosphate. It's a mineral. It's a mineral that you add to soil. You know, where we stay in the Goa and the Konkan area, the soils don't have a lot of phosphorus in it, and that can lead to some nutritional deficiencies in your plants. So it may not be available, or this may not be a problem in your area if your soils have a higher content of phosphorus, but in this part, Bombay and Konkan and the Kerala, you will find that this is quite useful to add. I have a bag here of wood ash. We have a bakery close by. I go and I often collect wood ash from them because it's a wood fired oven there. And basically, wood ash is a very effective pest repellent. Basically, it has the smell of fire. So a lot of pests detect that and they stay away from it. Also, it is corrosive. So if it gets onto, you know, a lot of these soft-bodied pests, it irritates them and they, you know, say, let's avoid this area, and they go elsewhere. So wood ash is another very effective, simple, and it does not harm your plants or your soil. In fact, it contains some amount of potassium in it, and it will actually add potassium to the soil, which is a good and a desirable thing. And I have something here called Trichoderma viridae. It's basically a fungus, a good fungus, and it's in a talcum medium. So it's in, you have talcum powder, and they keep the spores of this fungus in the talcum. There are many ways to use this. And you can basically, you know, drench the roots of certain plants like tomatoes, brinjal, chilies that suffer a particular problem of fungal wilt. And I'll just cover that in the subsequent slides. Now, there's a lot of stuff that, you know, I can say for this, do this, for this, do that. It's endless. We need to keep going back to the principles that we have to mimic nature and we have to do what we can to build great soil. If soil is healthy, your plants are healthy, they are resilient, and they're able to really combat a lot of the pest diseases that come their way. So I will move back to the presentation now. You know, here we have a photo from some of the pots that I've grown in the past. There's a bunch of lettuces, and we all aspire towards a garden, a productive garden that looks like that. And it boils down to largely growing the right plant in the right season in the best soil you can possibly create. And as a gardener, you are a steward of soil. Every day you need to be asking yourself, what have I done for my soil today? Okay, on to the next slide. So, you know, to think about the problem of pests, there are basically three categories. You either have pests, you have disease, and you have nutrition deficiencies that cause certain growth problems in your plants. And no matter what you look at, it will eventually come down to one of these three. So I'll take examples of some of the pest problems. You know, I've taken about 5 very common pest problems that we see in our areas. Karan, can you move to the next slide? So one of the most commonly observed pests in our area is aphids. Now these are really versatile guys. They are small, they can be yellow, they can be black, they can be green. They are usually found on the underside of leaves and they are sucking pests. There's a category of pests that basically, you know, suck the sap out of a plant. They create what is called honeydew and ants are attracted to this, as are viruses and fungus, and they create secondary problems of soot, black soot. It's a fungus problem, or it can also be an invitation for viruses to sort of make that their medium and grow, and then there will be a secondary problem to your plant. The plants that are usually affected by this are the mustard crops, which include cabbages and mustard greens and rocket and broccoli and that whole family. Beans, they love beans. You will find them growing along the stems, along the flowers, along the small young fruit as well. You'll see it often that these are carried by ants. So ants actually move these up and down the plant, because their movement is really slow, and they suck, they bring the honeydew out, and these ants, you know, they partake of that, and that's their little thing they have going there. There's a number of things you can do to prevent it. Make sure that you reduce congestion. Don't have too many plants together, because if there is a lot of humid and hot environment and moist environment, they get attracted to it. And that's true for a lot of pest and disease problems we have. Yellow and white sticky traps. These can be fairly useful and effective. And, you know, sprays like a neem oil spray in soap solution or a cow urine spray also deters and repels them. These are things you can do preventively. Curatively, once it's there, simply a jet spray of water will dislodge them. Soap solution sprays, chili, garlic, ginger sprays also can be effective. But like I said, we always aspire to a point where we don't reach the problem. Another common problem we see is that of a leaf miner. Leaf miners are basically, you see on your leaves, especially tomatoes, maybe even cucumbers, you see these squiggly lines. Basically, leaf miners are larvae of different kinds of flies, and they lay their eggs between the tissue of the leaves, and the larvae, they feed, they make these feeding tunnels until they sort of escape from the leaf once they're mature. And usually it is not that problematic unless it's a very widespread problem. When you see it, you know, press or squish the leaf at the point of the tunnel so that the larvae get squished inside, and you know, remove all the leaves and destroy them so that you don't have, you know, successive generations coming up. There are some natural predators for this. I forgot to mention the ladybug, the praying mantis, the spider. These are some of the natural predators that come to a garden and take care of a lot of these pests. So when we talk about creating an ecology, we like to have a bunch of these fellows, you know, doing their rounds on the beach, taking care of all the problems that seem to crop up. So that balance needs to be there. There are several things you can do to prevent it. You know, be vigilant. That's one of the main things, because this spreads. The minute you see a few of them, just discard it so that it does not spread quickly. Neem oil sprays sort of help keep it under control if the problem has become too widespread. Okay, moving on to mealybugs. Again, mealybugs and whiteflies. You can see, you know, the mealybug is the image on the top left, and the white flies are the little triangular fellows on the right. They are also sucking pests. They also create the same kind of problem. They will take the sap out. There will be honeydew or this sticky sweet substance that will attract fungus. There will be mold problems. And it's the primary problem are these guys, and then they create secondary problems of fungal and viral infections. Tomatoes, brinjals, beans, gourd, they love these crops. And hibiscus, yes. In fact, if you have a hibiscus plant, even guava, you'll find that they are really clustered around, especially the mealybugs. They'll be clustered around them, and you can use them as a great trap crop if you don't care for the hibiscus a whole lot. You know, cultivate healthy plants to prevent this problem from happening. Remove the affected parts that are there and avoid too much nitrogen. When you give a plant too much of compost or manure or, you know, anything that is high in nitrogen, it basically produces a lot of tender, fresh, new leaves. And these are extremely attractive to several pests. So, you know, just because a little, as one of our friends says, just because a little of something is good, a lot isn't always better. And that's very true in organic farming. You know, be measured in what you use and how much you use of it. That really helps a lot. Neem is a standard thing that is useful for a lot of them. Another fungus, a good fungus like Trichoderma, something called Bavaria bassania. It's basically a parasite, and if you you get it in a powder form or a liquid form, it can be sprayed in your garden. It is parasitic and it will kill a lot of these bugs, several of them, white flies and mealybugs included. Another common problem we have is that of caterpillars. Moving on to the next one. Now, caterpillars are basically larvae of different kinds of butterflies and moths. And there are numerous ones that you'll find. This is one, it's called the cabbage looper because it sort of loops and walks around. There are army worms, there are cut worms, there are a number of them. And it's good to get familiar with what it is that is there. Some of them feed only at night. So, you know, if you're spraying stuff in the daytime, it's going to be of no help. You've got to use light traps at night that will attract them and sort of get them down. So you have to know what the fellow is to have a more targeted sort of approach to controlling it. They affect, you know, various crops depending on which ones these are. The image down is that of it's a kale leaf. It's got nicely, eaten up patches inside, and you'll find sometimes if you look on the underside, small little wormy looking things, but they're actually caterpillars in clusters. You know, they create a lot of damage there. Preventive measures. One of the main things you can do is if you see one, just pick it and flick it. It's a really simple mechanical thing to do. Nothing to spray, nothing to worry about on your plants. It is effective. Of course, it needs you to be vigilant and timely with your interventions. Bird perches are great. And even if you have a bird feeder, that's a good way to attract birds in your garden. And they are superb pest managers. They'll come, they'll pick up these caterpillars and they'll sort of, you know, take care of half your problem. If you do have a whole lot of them, chili, garlic, ginger sprays work, neem oil works. We may have heard of BT cotton, and BT, it actually comes from a particular bacteria called Bacillus thuringiensis. And basically what this does is that once you spray it, if the caterpillar ingests it, it produces a protein that kills them. So it's very different from BT and GMO, and that can be another discussion. But basically, it is a biological control method that if you spray, it takes care of a lot of things like caterpillars and a bunch of other pests. Okay, moving on to the next one, we have thrips. Thrips is a tiny winged insect. It affects chilies, onions, strawberries, citrus, very commonly tomatoes also. Ladybugs and lacewings are the natural predators for these guys. You know, if there are some leaves that are badly affected, remove them, destroy them. The yellow and blue sticky traps are pretty effective for controlling these. And again, neem oil is good. Bavaria bassania, which I just spoke about, is pretty effective against these fellows. And wood ash is also something that can deter them coming around and, you know, breeding in that area. Okay, I'll move on to some of the diseases. And there's a whole lot of them. But like I said, it comes down to under the category of disease, you can either have a fungal problem, you can have a bacterial problem, or you can have a virus problem. And I'll give, not to mention viruses, this is not the right time, but plants also get affected by viruses. And it's not as drastic as we are going through right now. But with viruses, there is very less you can do once it's happened, once your plant has been affected. But I'll cover those as well. But one of the common problems we see is that of fungal wilt. It affects tomatoes, it affects brinjals, it affects chilies. Basically, the fungus grows, it constricts the passage of food up and down the plant, and the plant just wilts. It seems like you've not watered it, and that's pretty much the end of your plant. The transfer of this happens through spores that can go through the wind or it will flow through water. So you need to make sure that you are watchful of this problem. If a plant has it, remove it, destroy it. I mentioned Trichoderma viridae. That's one of the good funguses that if it's populated if it's populated your soil, it will prevent the fungal wilt causing bacteria from or fungus from growing in the soil. I'll get on to the next one. There are quite a few to cover. Mildew. Now, mildew can be of quite a few types, but the most commonly occurring ones you see is powdery mildew. That's the top image you see. There's a fine coating of powder, very common in cucumber and different kinds of cucurbits. Or even the second one that's below there, which is the downy mildew. That produces these yellow spots. And basically what this is fungal growth. It comes because you have either a very congested growing space, the ventilation is poor, there is insufficient sunlight, it's continuously humid and moist. So those are things you must avoid. Once you have it, you can do a spray of a baking soda, one tablespoon to a liter of water. That being alkaline changes the pH of the, of the area of the leaves and all that, and it prevents the growth of this fungus in that area. So that's the thing you can do to sort of prevent it, but cut, remove badly infected bits and just get rid of them. Now, here is one that is about nutrition deficiency. So blossom end rot. I think last time someone asked us about tomato and they said that there is a spot on the tomato that looks like it's rotting. Now, this is not fungal, not bacterial. This is actually a deficiency of calcium in the soil. Now, what happens is you do have calcium in the soil, but if your soil is inconsistently moist, like sometimes there's too much water, sometimes it's dry for long periods, tomatoes can suffer problems. Like they can have tomato, it'll crack the fruit, or you'll end up with this kind of a spot on it that looks watery. You can't really do much. Once this is there, this is there. The fruit looks unsightly. You can cut off the bits, but if you're growing commercially, then nobody would buy fruit like that. So that's a big problem. But in your own home and from your own garden, just slice off the bits and you can use the rest of the tomato. But make sure that you're watering your soil consistently, not over watering, but just watering it consistently. And have slow release fertilizers like goat manure, because what that does is doesn't give too much nitrogen. Sometimes it's not so much the lack of calcium as it is the presence of excess nitrogen that can also create this imbalance in the plant. Okay, I've covered quite a few there, and I could keep going on about this pest and that disease and this fungus and that virus, but the bottom line is build resilient plants by building good soil. And I'm going to hand over to Karan to take it up from there.
Thanks, Yogita. So, we've taken a fair bit of time, I think, to get to this point, because there's been a lot to cover. But given that so many of you had questions, about pests and disease in particular, we thought it would be good to go into some detail so that you have a sense how to solve these. Now, we've created a table which helps you identify many of the problems and suggest solutions for them. This will be a document that we will also upload to the, resource folder, which is on the Google Drive. So, if you just look at the Anyone Can Grow page on HasGreek, you will find a link to that folder. We will probably also send it in a summary email that we send over to you, right? Okay, so there are some things to keep in mind in the context of managing pests and disease, and I'd like to just, go over these again to summarize it. The first thing, really, really important, and I absolutely understand why it feels like this is counterintuitive. When we started out, we would also obsess about pests and disease. But you realize after a little bit of growing that, we gave it sometimes too much attention. And therefore, I would suggest that we should stop obsessing about diseases and pests. What we should do is we should make every effort to manage the environment within which our plants are growing, in order to, just prevent the occurrence of these diseases and pests. You cannot completely eliminate them. As Yogita said, it's, a part of the cycle of nature also. So we have to accept it, and we have to treat it as a symptom of something else being wrong. And that is what we have to try and address in the long term. Lastly, you need to really, as a gardener, I think one of the greatest skills that you can have and the greatest skills that you can develop is the ability to observe very closely, to understand and, see, notice and understand things that are happening in your garden, spotting pests earlier, identifying pests earlier, and making sure that you are able to come up with the particular solution for that problem, either as a cure immediately or, like Yogita was mentioned, as a preventive measure to be implemented in the next season, right? Now, a quick summary of everything that we've talked about in this session. The first thing that we have tried to talk about and try to stress, and I think we've been talking about this right through the different sessions, is that soil health is a huge part of ensuring health. So, you know, as gardeners, we have to understand that nature does most of the work for us, or at least nature should be doing most of the work for us. And our job is not to get in the way of nature, but to assist it when necessary. So soil health, especially in pots, is something that we can influence to a great extent. And that's something each of us should kind of focus on. And when you solve that particular problem, you have healthy, strong plants. So you have strong seedlings, healthy seedlings going into healthy soil, building up their, you know, their growth, I mean, their size in terms of growth and things like that, and their food reserves and immunity, and therefore being productive for us. The second thing is, I would say more than half of us tend to overwater our plants. And this very overwatering causes fungal diseases. This is particularly true in the coastal parts where humidity tends to be high. Like at this time of the year, we probably have 80%, you know, humidity in places like Bombay, in places like Cochin, in places like Chennai or even Goa, right? And that, you know, that humidity combined with overwatering is a perfect, you know, recipe for fungal disaster. Mulching is a very powerful tool. And if you don't take anything else away from this session, I would say that, you know, you should take away the idea that mulching is something that you must do in your garden. And you can usually find mulch leaves either in your compound or in your neighborhood. These are usually burnt, just adding to pollution in our cities. And these can be used productively in your garden. Just collect them and put them into your pots. Make it a 2-inch layer that covers your soil. Diversity is something you must ensure in order to have protection against pests. Diversity leads to more, you know, sort of resilient ecosystems. And this is better for the health and well-being of your plants. And lastly, or in a sense, firstly, you want to take preventive action well before time to avoid pests. When you do experience them, you do the best you can cure, but you then incorporate a new practice in for the next season so that that same pest does not occur. Quite often, you may have a pest in your balcony that I do not experience at all in my garden. So it's impossible to cover every single pest and make sure you have a remedy for it. That brings us pretty much to the end of this session. I'd like to first talk a little bit about the session that we are going to have next week. As I mentioned earlier, this is the last session of this 5-part series, which I hope you have found informative. I hope you found it useful. This will be on Thursday, which is the 7th of May. And what we shall cover in that session will be the proper time and way in which you can harvest your vegetables, how you can plan your next crop, and make sure that you have seedlings ready at the right time when one cycle of crop ends. We shall also talk about growing fruits in pots, which is something that many of us don't even consider possible, but it is very possible to do. You can have larger pots, maybe 18 inch, that's 1.5 foot of 2 foot size, or 20 inch pots. And you can grow trees, fruit trees in them for the next 5-10 years with a lot of productivity of fruits, right? So this, I think, is something that we'll cover also. For friends who you may want to give the link to register for this session, please note the link is hasgeek.com/green-essentials, right? /anyone can grow series. You'll see the link right here at the bottom. Since you've already used it, most likely to sign up, you would already be familiar for it. This is also where you will be able to access the past editions of, editions of this series. The videos are up over there, and the different resources that we are, providing as part of this also. Again, I hope, this has been an interesting session for you. What I'm going to do is I'm going to just ask Amok to share a couple of polls with you for which we'd like your feedback. Amog, is it possible to do the first polls? Yeah. Okay. So, you know, it'd be great to know how many of you are actually joining us for the first time and how many, you know, have been there for the past sessions. I'll just wait for half a minute while the remaining people can let us know. So a lot of you joining us for the first time, as a reminder, you can view the past sessions over the last 4 weeks now. This is the fourth session. And the fifth one would be coming on 7th May. Okay. There's a second poll, if you can kind of answer for us. This will give us a sense of, you know, how much you've actually grown. And for those of us who are joining us for the second or third time, what kind of progress you've made. Oh, several of you seem to have seedlings underway. That's good to know. For those who haven't started, it would be great if you can start early, perhaps on this weekend itself, simply because, you know, the seasons will change from June onwards when the monsoons will come along. Right? So thanks for those responses. There's a third poll also, Amog, which after this we can probably... Thanks so much for this feedback, because it gives us a lot of guidance on what we should cover and, you know, how we should sort of do this. Okay, excellent. So just moving on from here, I just wanted to mention that a lot of you can, you know, get onto this group that we've created on Telegram. Telegram is something like WhatsApp. It's a messaging app, but it's a little more powerful in terms of helping us share information with you and, you know, interact with you. The link to do this is t.me/anyonecangrow. So if you type this into your browser and click on it, it will take you to a place where you can sign up and actually access the interactive chat room that we are using, for these sessions, as a follow-up for these sessions. If you have more questions that you come across, you know, it would be great to kind of hear from you. And if you can share examples of what you're doing, we can probably help with more guidance. You know, thank you for being a part of this session. And I just wanted to mention that we can be reached also on info@greenessentials.in. The address may not be very visible on your screen, so I'll repeat it. It's info@greenessentials.in. You can send in your emails here too if you have some questions. But the best way, place to be interact would be on Telegram, t.me/anyonecangrow. Right? So what we'll do next is that we will have a quick Q&A session. I can see there are a lot of questions that have been sent in. I'll ask Hasgeek to just let us know what these questions are. I think Anish will be helping us with this.
Yeah, perhaps. Thanks, Karan. That was a very interesting session. Thanks, Yogita. So we have a bunch of questions on various topics. I'm going to go from topic to topic. We have questions on watering, soil, and pest management, and diseases. So I'll go in that order. I'll start off with... watering the soil, watering the plants. So Ashish Nabar asks, what is the optimum amount of water required for various plants? Is there any resource that you can use for this?
So if you have plants in a pot, then I would say you water it deeply so that the water emerges from the bottom of the container. So the entire pot, the entire column of soil there is wet. The reason for that is that the roots will grow nice and deep and you'll have a well-rooted plant in that pot. And then you water next when you see that the soil looks dry. And how do you find that out? Either you see, but don't just see the surface. The surface will usually look dry. Just poke about an inch under. And if the soil is moist, then you can skip a day, skip 2 days.
So I... Just a minute while Yogita, yeah.
Can you hear me? So, you like right now I water my, it's summer, but it's very humid. So the soil doesn't dry up as fast. And some of the pots where I've been raising my nurseries, I've been watering them once every third day. They continue to stay and hold the moisture for a long time. So the indicator is that you need to see how wet your soil is. And the same thing is true for a garden as well. If it seems moist, just skip it. Don't water again. Otherwise, you will create that high humidity continuously and there will be fungal problems from there. I hope that answers your question.
So just adding to what Yogita just said, the first thing is that a lot depends on the nature of your soil. If you remember, we talked about adding coco peat in. So when you got coco peat, it holds moisture for a much longer period of time, right? So that's one of the reasons why Yogita will have to water less. Also, Yogita's pots are mulched heavily. So for that reason, water stays for a longer period of time. So again, you know, you will have to learn to judge this a little bit. And as Yogita said, the best way is to poke your finger in and look for soil moisture. You are not supposed to have a wet soil. You're supposed to have moist soil. So that's one thing that you should kind of keep in mind, right? And the other thing that you should keep in mind is that if you see algae or moss growing on the surface of the soil, it's an indication that most likely you're overwatering, right? Or that the drainage in that particular pot for some reason is improper. So you can check the drainage. If the drainage is fine, then just cut down the watering to until that, you know, goes away. Because if there's no excess water, it's not going to form on the surface of the soil.
Got it. So moving on to questions on soil and soil health. We have a question from Pankaj. He asks, is there any procedure that he can follow for preparing a healthy organic culture of bacteria in his soil?
So the first thing is that because, okay, so since we leave, most of us, I mean, it depends in which, you know, city you are or what kind of climatic location you are. But for the most part in India, we've got tropical climates. Now, tropical climates are always rich in microbes in any case. So you don't have to worry about specific microbes being added to the soil. All you need to do is create an environment where they can thrive, right? So I would say that the first thing to do in order to allow your soil microbes to thrive is to mulch your soil. That will immediately create a conducive environment along with the moisture that it holds for them to propagate and grow. Now, suppose you don't have soils that are rich in, you know, these kind of microbes. Yogita gave you the example of Panchakavya, that stinky bottle she had on her table. Basically, if you recall, she'd mentioned that it has, you know, many different, five different types of things from the cow, like milk, curd, cow dung, cow urine, and so on. Basically, it's like an Ayurvedic cocktail for plants, which is very rich in microbes. So if I were to feel that my soil is a little depleted, what I would do is that I would just make a solution of this. You have to put just about 30 ml in a liter of water. That's like a 0.03% solution. And I would add it into the soil like a liquid fertilizer, right? And then I would cover it with mulch above, because there would be no point adding in those microbes if I'm going to let them die by not mulching, right? The sunlight is going to sterilize them, right? So very soon you will find that the populations of microbes in your soil will also revive. And there is enough diversity of microbial populations in that concoction that your soil will be much better, right? So I hope that Yogita wants to just add to that. Yeah.
Okay. So another thing, like if you don't have access to Panchagavya, I find that my pots are very close to the kitchen. I often have curds that are, you know, have become too sour and you don't want to eat it. So you just dilute that with water and pour it, distribute it amongst all your plants. You get excellent lactobacillus into it. Then if you have milk, you know, just swirl the milk container, put that in. That will also attract more lactobacillus and it will sort of create that culture there. Anything that you think has microbes and can get into your soil, don't throw it away from your kitchen. Dilute it in water and just, you know, distribute it amongst your plants. That will build a variety of different kinds of microbes in your soil. You know, if you part your soil and, yeah, even if you eat non-veg and you're cleaning fish, the fish water, the rice water, all these stimulate the growth of microbes. I was going to say, sometimes when you pat your soil and you see that inside the soil, there's like this white stuff inside, fuzzy white stuff. Sometimes people freak out seeing it, but that's excellent. That's like fungal mycelium inside, and you want your soil to look like that. So, you know, be happy if you see that. It's not bad. It's not a problem. If you're unsure what it is, send us a photo and we'll tell you whether it's the good stuff or the bad stuff.
Okay. So I think that's quite clear. Speaking of fungal mycelium, we have a question from Pallavi. She asks, she has some kind of white fungus growing on her soil, and the plant slowly just tends to rot. The root of the plant tends to rot and die away. So what exactly is happening and what should she do about it?
So Pallavi, two parts. One is that it would be great to have a photograph. So if you're able to post a photograph to the Telegram group, that would let us be very sure that the problem you're facing is something that we are identifying correctly, right? Having said that, root rot can happen for multiple reasons, right? So one example, I am just taking an example, not directly linked to the fungus kind of thing that she's described. But one example is the soil has some things called nematodes, okay? So it works in an interesting way. And this is a common problem, for example, in tomatoes. It is also a common problem, I think, in bananas. So what happens is these nematodes are sort of microscopic creatures in the soil. You cannot see them. And what they do is that they create, you know, damage in the roots. So the symptom, I mean, the sign of the problem, sorry? Yeah. So they create colonies on the roots, which create blockages in the roots. And they affect the ability of the roots to pick up nutrients and pass them up to the stem and other parts of the plant, right? So more or less what happens is the food or the nutrition and water supply of the plants goes off. And the plant can go from being very healthy to suddenly just collapsing. And the only way you will know is when you pull out the plant and you look at the roots and you find all these clumps or nodules on the roots below, right? So this is one kind of root rot that can happen. There are other fungal related root rots also, which could be possibly the reason that she's facing this problem. But it would help really to have a photograph so that we can identify it correctly and suggest what she can do.
Okay. We have a couple of questions related to fertilizers or additives to the soil. The first question is from Kora Bhatia. The question is regarding panchagavya to water ratio and the frequency in which it should be added. And the second question is from Sunila. She asks, how much of rock phosphate should be added to the soil?
Okay. So panchagavya can be added in a 3% solution. Basically, is that in 1 liter of water, put in 30 ml of half a peg, if you will, in water, dilute it, and you can put it in a spray bottle like this, and you can spray your plants, or you can water the soil. If you're using a sprayer, remember to strain it, because you may find particles of cow dung floating in it, and it can clog the spray nozzle. So that, and the frequency with which, you know, if you think the soil isn't very good, then you can initially add it once every 15 days, maybe for 3 or 4 applications. And then after that, you know, once a month should be sufficient. Remember, plants growing in pots are limited to the extent that they have food based on the size of the pot. So if you have a larger container, obviously there will be more nutrients available and you will have to add nutrients to it less frequently. If you have smaller containers, then you will have to regularly add that. Unlike growing in the garden, where there is a certain ecology that takes over and these sort of multiply and build on their own. So you have to do it more frequently in pots. Regarding the rock phosphate, I would put in, so a little bit about rock phosphate. It's basically a mineral dust or rock dust. It is good for creating healthy cellular growth, good for the times of flowering and, you know, when the plants are blooming. It is a very slow release kind of nutrient. It doesn't get, it is not soluble in water and will not get washed away in the rains, unlike, you know, the nitrogen that is available from cow dung and different kinds of manures. So once you add this, if you add, I would add about, this is a kilo, 1 kilo, I would mix it with about a 40 kilo bag of compost, I'm saying in a garden, and spread it over 10 square meters. Now that's the ratio in the land. But if you're adding it to a pot, I would say 1 teaspoon is sufficient. And the point is that once you add it, you can, you know, forget about it for a couple of seasons. You don't have to add a couple of seasons. I mean, like maybe a year or two. You don't need to add it again and again. But the critical thing about this is that if you have phosphorus, rock phosphate in your soil, and you don't have a healthy microbial population, this will not be available to your plants. There are certain bacteria that solubilize or basically make phosphorus into a form that is available to the plants. So mulching is really critical. If you're using this, that's why we mix it with compost, because compost has its own set of microbes, or you can add a little bit of panchagavya to it. Add it together with the rock phosphate and mulch so that the bacteria population continues to thrive, and they are, like Karan said, the chefs. They cook and they keep feeding the plants what is there in the soil. So that's the other important thing to keep in mind.
I'll just add to that, you know, Yogita referred to the fact that one needs to have the right size of pot, right? So just for people who have joined in this session itself, I'd like to point out that we've discussed the appropriate sizes of pots for different plants earlier. There is also a table in the same presentation and in the earlier session that you can look at, which tells you what size of pot you should have for which plant. Yeah.
Okay. Moving on to the next set of questions. We have a couple of questions on mulch and how to use it. We have an attendee who asks if excess mulch causes results in excess hydrogen in the soil. We also have another question from Joy. He says he's been collecting leaves from the neighborhood for mulch. He's asking if he risks introducing pests and bugs if he does not check the leaves carefully.
Okay, the first question was whether excess mulch produces hydrogen. I'm not familiar
with nitrogen.
No, it does not produce extra nitrogen. You know, anything that first decomposes, in fact, does the opposite. It takes nitrogen out before giving it in. But mulch as a top layer does not really do that. It will slowly decompose and it will slowly get added to your soil. So I don't think that there is a problem of excess nitrogen or reduction in nitrogen levels in the soil. And remember, you need to put in dry mulch. If you put in like grass clippings that are fresh and green, what can happen, for example, is that they'll start decomposing. When it's fresh, it will go through the process of decomposition. It will get squelchy, it may get matted, and that's where it can create pathogens that will multiply, and then that can affect your plants. So you need to watch out for not, don't use fresh leaves and fresh grass clippings and things, just use dry stuff. Now, you need to watch whether you are bringing in, you know, pathogens or pests into your garden from other places. I would say there is a danger of that happening, but, you know, healthy, resilient soils can handle a bit of it. So, there is a lot of stuff everywhere, and I would, the benefits that mulch provides far outweighs the slight risk of getting something from outside. If you are concerned about it, you can spread it out in the sun for a little while and let it sort of cook, if you will, or get slightly disinfected in the sun. That will maybe take care of a lot of the either pests or disease that may be there, and then use it. Don't bring it in and directly use it if that's a concern. Just put it out in the sun, spread it, let it dry out nicely, crisp, and then you can add it. I think that should prevent problems of that type.
I'd also add that what you can perhaps do is be a little selective of where you get the mulch from, in the sense that, you know, usually it's just swept up from the concrete in a garden or something. You're not likely to have any major, you know, pathogens over there. That's very unlikely. You know, if you have dank, you know, wet kind of moist corners, that those may be the places where you have it. So if it's relatively dry and, you know, coming from a place which seems relatively clean, you really won't have any issues.
Okay. We have a couple more questions on mulch and the amount of mulch to use. Deviki us, she sort of had to get rid of some soil that was in her pot and add some more soil to it. So she was asking, and the previous soil already had some mulch in it. She asked if she needs to provide more mulch to the new soil covering. And there's another question on YouTube where somebody is asking if they have about 2 inches of mulch that they've given. Should they make it lesser or is it sufficient?
Okay. To answer Devaki's question, the mulch has to be on top. If you have some soil in your pot and you're adding fresh soil to it, I would put it on top of the mulch. Like, I'm not able to understand what you've done, but if you are adding fresh soil to it, and if your soil is there, the simple rule is you should not be able to see your soil. If you can see your soil, you don't have enough mulch. So basically, if you're adding fresh soil or adding compost to your pot, remove the dry leaves, put them aside, do your mixing in your soil, whatever, set it, level it, and put the mulch back on top. And to answer the second question, 2 inches of mulch is perfect. It's great. 2 inches will make sure that you can't see your soil. So that's good. Remember, mulch will decompose over time. So you will have to keep topping it up. So keep a steady supply of mulch handy in a bag or something that you can always reach out for and top up the mulch when you see that it has depleted.
I'll just add a couple of things to that. If we were growing in a garden outdoors, we may put in as much as 3-inch layer or even 4-inch layer of mulch, because there tends to be more breeze and it can get blown away. And, you know, it's also a larger space and it compacts. So we may do that. In a pot, 2 inches is, you know, kind of all you can manage. That's one. The second thing is, for mulch, you can, remember, you can take something like dry grass clippings. You can take, you know, even weeds we've used, as long as they are not flowering. And as soon as the roots, as long as the roots are clipped off. And what we do is that sometimes you may end up with like large leaves. For example, I think a common city plant tree is the badam tree, which has these very thick leaves that decompose slowly and they're also very large. So what you would do is that you would just break down the leaves into smaller leaves just to make them more manageable. You know, especially when it's in pots, it's very difficult to arrange bigger leaves. So just break them down into smaller pieces and, you know, they will do the job also. If possible, try and make sure you have a mix of leaves. Again, following the diversity principle and saying that, you know, each of these plant trees probably has roots to different levels and brings up different minerals, right? So if you are able to do that, but if not, that's not a big problem either. Again, I think we mentioned it in the past, work with what you have. And, if some things are just too inconvenient, don't worry, work with the things that are easily accessible to you.
Okay, so now we are just moving on to some kind of soil additives that improve the health of the soil, questions on these. We have a question on YouTube where this person is asking if Epsom salt increases the micronutrient absorption in the soil. We have another question from Devaki regarding this. She asks if Jeevamrit can be used for all kinds of leafy vegetables and fruiting vegetables apart from just fruiting trees.
So the first question, which is really related to the use of Epsom salts. So very frankly, I'll have to look that up because it's not something that we use regularly. Now, we know that this is commonly recommended in many places, but one of the principles we try to follow is, what is good enough is good enough. And there is no point trying to make absolutely the perfect mix because the effort and the cost involved in doing that is too high. So we found that even with the nutrients that we mentioned, we've had extremely productive results and we've never had to resort to something that is very specific. Like, I'll give you examples of things like this. A lot of people will tell us that they'll use perlite or vermiculite. They'll add that to the soil. There is this blue rock dust that is also added to the soil. There are many other little kind of micronutrients that are added to the soil. Frankly, we've not bothered with these. And, there's a parallel thing. So since we run a garden store, we have a lot of people coming up with all kinds of very innovative bio fertilizers which have secret special formulae and whatnot. Some will say that they've got sea kelp and this and that and everything. And personally, we've just found that you know, it becomes a little bit of over engineering, right? So sorry that I can't give you the answer immediately. If you can join the Telegram group and kind of, you know, just send this message in there, I'll try and answer that question after a little bit of research. That's one part of it. The second question was about Jeevamrit. Yeah, Jeevamrit is great. It's given us very good results with flowering and fruiting, you know, so really, really good in that sense. I would say that it is, you know, Panchgavya or Jeevamrit both do a great job. Personally, I find Panchgavya is best used on the soil, but can also be used as a foliar spray. Jeevamrit, Yogita, are we using more in the soil or in the soil? Okay, mostly in the soil. So again, right in over there, just to, you know, water to the root zone. Though I suppose you can apply it as a foliar spray also, but that effect tends to go away quicker.
Okay. I think that's about it when it comes to soil, questions on soil. We'll move on to questions on pests and diseases. A few of them have already been covered, but I think they're like failed attempts at remedying the issue. So maybe I can sort of go through them quickly. We have a question from Tanvi. She says that her tomato and Rajnigandha plants were infected by mealybugs, and she used a fermented rice water solution and neem oil, but it hasn't completely worked. She wants some advice on how to deal with it. She asks if changing the soil completely will help. I think we'll just finish that question and then move on to the rest.
So, you know, usually, and this takes us back to, like, you need to look at what exactly is going on with that plant. It's not just about what you have sprayed and it hasn't worked. And very often you will spray something and it will not work. And you spray something else and it will still not work. And you've got to really get to the root of the problem. And it could simply be something as small as your plant isn't getting enough sunlight. Like, is your tomato plant getting 5 to 6 hours of sunlight? Rajnigandha, I have very little experience with ornamentals, so I'm not familiar, but I imagine because it's a flowering plant, it would also like more sunlight. Are you growing it in the right kind of environment? Is it too humid there? Is it, you know, too much growing in that one area where it is all overcrowded? So it's not about what you have sprayed, because that is literally the tip of the iceberg, or the last kind of the last effort. There's all this stuff which we spoke about earlier, and you know, it's are all those parameters being met? Because the plant dying is an indication of something that is not happening, or something that is happening that runs far beyond just that one instance over there. So that, treat it not as an end, but as an indicator of what is happening. So it's hard for me to give a specific answer to that, that, okay, you have these mealybugs and your plants have died because of it. Mealybugs love moist environment. Mealybugs love, you know, shaded areas to grow. So, you know, look at the place where your plants are growing and see if you can bring about any change on those parameters. And that may, you know, help having healthier plants in the future.
So, you know, just taking what Yogita said and maybe putting it in a little bit of a different order. The first thing I would look at is that, have I created too wet and humid an environment, you know, for mealybugs? And that could be either because I'm watering too much. So you should think about that a little bit. The second thing may be, like Yogita said, it's a very shaded environment and a lot of, you know, humidity tends to be trapped there. Is my plant too dense? Can I prune it and reduce the size of the, you know, the canopy? Are you giving it too much nitrogen, for example, too much fertilizer, which is creating the environment? I'm just talking it about it in terms of steps. So maybe you can move it out to a sunnier area where there's better air circulation, and that will have better results to you. You know, is there another plant nearby which is the source? Like we gave the example of shoe flower, for example, or hibiscus, which tends to be the magnet. Is this bringing the mealybugs into your environment and creating those problems? I'm not sure. I think in the last session, somebody said a neighbor's plant, for instance, was contributing to a lot of mealybugs in their garden itself, right? So those are the things that I would address first, because unless you address those issues that are causing the problem, cures will be either less effective or not effective at all, because the problem will keep coming back.
Okay. So we have a couple of questions on red ants and termites in kitchen gardens. Joy has a bunch of small red ants around his kitchen garden. He asks if it's something to worry about. We also have a question on YouTube from Alka Tandon. She says she has a lot of termites around in her kitchen garden that looks something like Dimak. And seems to not let any plants grow in the garden. Yeah, she asks what has to be done in this case.
So there are, I learned recently, actually, we have this 11-year-old boy called Ethan who comes and spends time at our store. And he's really, he calls himself the ant guy. And he identified 30 different kinds of ants just in our store garden. And I thought they were ants. There were red ants and black ants and white ants and that's it. But it seems that there are so many kinds of ants. There are ants that fly. There are ants that, the male, the female, whatever. There's a whole bunch of them. So you need to actually know a little bit more about what the ant is. But, you know, to give a shorter answer, observe. Just look at your plant and see how your plant is doing. Like, there are some ants that just don't do anything. They'll just go up and down in the soil. They'll do their thing and they won't worry your plant at all. So, if that's the case, I once had, I'm trying to remember what was growing in it. It was some leafy vegetable and it was in the balcony and this was during summer. Now, ants like moist environment. So, the soil is nice and moist. They come from under the pot and they're down, like they just stay somewhere at the lower portion of the pot. They have colonies. They'll have, you know, their eggs that they'll have all over there. And every time I would water the plant, they would all come out from the bottom. They'd wait for the water to drain out. And then once the water dried out, they'd all go back in. So I noticed that they were not really harming the plant in any way. It may be you get freaked out seeing, are so many ants are coming and going and I don't like it and I want to do something about it. But, you know, if you have a garden, you will have ants. And you just need to observe and see whether it's causing any damage. If it is causing damage, then it's of concern to you. Like if it's moving around aphids and things, then you may want to say, okay, I need to deter those particular ants. Otherwise, not needed.
So just coming back to, what I think there were two questions, one about ants and one about white ants. Let me say this first, ants are part of the ecosystem. Right? No matter what you do, especially if you are in, for instance, coastal areas and not in temperate areas, you cannot get rid of ants. As Yogita said, you've got 30 different types of ants and they're part of the ecosystem. In fact, they are assisting in many ways because they are breaking down organic matter, which then gets incorporated into the soil, improving the quality of your soil, right? The role that they may be playing could be secondary roles. We had talked about aphids a little earlier and they are bringing aphids in to kind of suck the pests and all. But, ants are not typically the primary villains in your garden. That's number one. Now, this also goes for white ants, which in my opinion are much misunderstood. Now, white ants tend to eat matter or attack matter, which is either dead or dying. So, it is one thing for it to attack, for instance, the door frame in your house. That's because it's dead wood and, it does it. But in terms of a living plant, its cellular structure is so different that they typically cannot really they cannot consume the material that a living plant is made of. Right. So this is an important consideration to keep in mind. Many times we do not like these creatures for reasons other than what is, their main kind of function within the garden. So it's not that they're harming your plants, but they seem to be around and sometimes there's just circumstantial evidence against them. So that's how they kind of get caught and we tend to, feel that they may be causing problems. For the most part, I don't think we have to worry about them and, they can go about their business without interfering with what we are trying to do.
Okay. The next set of questions are on cockroaches and rats in balcony gardens. We have a question on YouTube. The attendee asks if there's any way of getting rid of cockroaches from the balcony garden. Also, Neha seems to have a very health conscious rat who eats only spinach and salad greens. She asks if there are any suggestions on how to keep the rats away.
Okay, so I mean, see, both of these issues usually will, cockroaches especially, cockroaches are very urban phenomenon. And, you know, it's more to do with conditions in your neighborhood, you know, maybe garbage some distance away or whatever. So I think that cockroaches you deal with completely differently than this. Like, I have never seen cockroaches being there because of a garden. Okay, so that's one part of the answer. So you deal with them like I have to deal with them every once in a while, which is all it requires is a chappal, and you deal with them. You know, for those people who don't like to intervene in that way, I don't have any, you know, immediate suggestions to sort of offer. Okay, then comes the issues of rats and mice, and they can be quite problematic. Now, again, the question is, how are they coming in? Quite often, I remember having a house in which, you know, the rat would actually climb up the drain pipe and come up like three floors up, you know, so that can be quite a challenge. Now, in terms of rats in general, the most effective way we found of dealing with them are actually rat traps. And I'll give you the example, because we have these different kinds of composts and soils, you know, we will frequently have rats wandering their way in. Our store is also outside the city, so it's, you know, a less urban kind of place. So you'll have a mouse or a rat coming in. And, you know, the rat trap is like magic. Literally, you put it down and you, sometimes you can just put a little bag of compost or soil over there, and that works as a lure. They come for it, they gobble at it, they're trapped in the rat. And then you take it for a long ride to your least favorite neighborhood, to the city, and get rid of it. You know, a lot of people actually kill them. We can't get ourselves to do that, so we just, you know, go three villages away and release the rat over there. Yeah, so I really think that in the context of an apartment, and, you know, also where you may have other pests, you don't want to use many of the rat poisons and other things, even though these are available. I really think the most effective way of dealing with it is either by adopting a good female cat. Yogita insist that the males are too lazy to be useful, and or on the other side, you know, you just have a rat trap. These, I would say, are the best. So when in the organic way of thinking, we would say you don't have a rat problem, you have a cat deficiency. So that's really how we look at it.
Okay, we have another question from Devaki. She asks, She has a brinjal plant that flowered for the first time this week, but the flower just wilted away in a day, and there was no fruits. So she's asking what the problem could be.
There could be a couple of things. It could be that there are no pollinators around, so it didn't get pollinated. Though I think it's a self-pollinated flower, so that shouldn't have been the problem. It could also be that your soil is deficient in potassium, and potassium, rather a deficiency of potassium, can cause premature falling of flowers or fruit. A quick and easy way to add potassium into your soil is by adding a little bit of wood ash, which you can get from any baker that does baking, or I don't know where you are, but you should be able to get wood ash from someone who runs a tandoor. Maybe that will be more of charcoal ash. Get a little bit of, don't burn leaves, because the potassium content in that is a lot less, but just woody bits. If you just burn a bit of it, collect the ash and put it in the soil. Don't use too much, because it changes the pH of the soil considerably. So in a pot that's about like a 10-inch pot or a 12-inch pot, you can add a couple of tablespoons. That should be enough. If you happen to live by the sea, you can take a walk and collect up some seaweed, wash it nicely so that the salt is out. And you can just either let the seaweed dry on your soil and eventually decompose in the soil, or you can actually make like a seaweed liquid sort of tonic. Just leave it in water for several days and use that water for your plants. Seaweed is also pretty high in potassium. So those are two ways I think you should be able to address the problem. Wood ash being the quickest.
I know we have gone longer than we anticipated, but, you know, happy to sort of answer the questions as best we can.
Yeah, hi. I just had some problems with connectivity. I think it's, we have a couple questions on cocopeat and compost, vermicompost.
Okay.
We have a question on YouTube. Peter asks where he can find the vermicompost and cocopeat in Goa. We have a question from Rina, who asks if cocopeat can be used for tube gardening, like in the pictures that you had shown in the presentation.
Okay.
And we have another question from Akansha. She says it's quite difficult to find a vermicompost or any kind of manure during lockdown. Is there any home made a nutrient solution that can be used on the plant instead?
Okay, so I will answer, you know, the first question, which is that in terms of availability in cocopeat and vermicompost in Goa, it's fairly easily accessible. Most nurseries will tend to have it. I'm not sure where Peter is located, but for instance, in the north, we have our store in Sukkur. It's available there. It's also available at other gardening stores, you know, in Giri and other places like that. In the south, I guess, east, west, or Kokoda, these are different places that may have vermicompost and cocopeat. Most garden stores will have it. In terms of the second question, using cocopeat as the medium in those pipes, that those kind of pipe gardens, yes, certainly that is the medium. You're not going to use soil there. It's going to be a blend of cocopeat and vermicompost. I think you could get away with 70-30 or 50-50. You can 50-50 in leafy vegetables is better because that extra punch kind of gives you a lot of vegetative growth and more leaf production. So yeah, since you have a smaller volume of you know, soil, you may want to try 50-50 vermicompost and cocopeat for those pipes. The third question was with regards to cocopeat as, I'm sorry, could you just run that by me? The last question, Anish?
The question was regarding having a home compost.
Yes, okay. How do you manage for nutrients while we are locked down? Okay, so the first thing is that the best way to do it is to compost your own kitchen waste, right? So it takes a little bit of time, but you can start getting your compost within a few weeks itself, right? If you accelerate the process of composting, and home composting makes the most sense because of that. Now, assuming that you don't have this at this point, and obviously it'll take a while before you can get started with it, mulching is the second process, which is progressively sort of adding nutrients to your soil, right? So you add dry leaves into your soil, and definitely over your soil. As it decomposes, it brings more organic matter in and it gets nutrients in. The third way you can do it is, I don't know whether you have fish and meats and things like that, but if they are actually, if your discarded fish or cleaned off fish or something is actually kept in water solution and actually fermented with jaggery for a short period of time, then what happens is it's going to smell like hell. So you make sure that you have it inside a closed container. But I think it should take what, about 18 days or so, 15 days or so, before it is really rich liquid nutrient. Yeah, you will have to dilute and use this. Do not use this straight off. It is simply too strong. I think about 10% should be fine, 10 to 12% concentration, maximum of 15%. That's the range in which you should use this. So you put in about 100 to 150 ml in 1 liter of water, and that would be the right kind of way to use it. Yogita just wants to add a few things. So
you can also use things like rice water, curd water, milk water, anything water. You boil potatoes and there's water lying around. It'll have some nutrients from the potato in it. Add that in. So it's a continuous process. It's not a one-time thing that you do. It's something that, like, I'm washing the dishes where the plants are. So every time I see something that I feel, oh, this could be useful, just swirl the container in. And continuously you'll find that you're building up the microbes in the soil. And like Karan said, the mulch, you add dry leaves to your soil, that also increases the organic matter. That is where all the microbes thrive. So those are the things you can also do.
Okay. We have a question from Satish. He asks if it's safe to use STP treated water for vegetable gardens.
Okay, there is the theory and there is the practice, because STP also, it all depends on how well that treatment is actually working. So unless you're confident that it's operating very well, where, you know, the usually you need to test the output of these and make sure that it's in a certain range, I would avoid it. But if you are sure that, you know, the quality is up there in terms of what is being actually collected afterwards, then yes, it can be used. Like we know, we for instance had a client, in fact a hotel, that was actually using it to grow vegetables organically, and it was absolutely fine. But it was fine because they had complete control over and very closely monitored the output from the STP itself, right? So I hope that answers the question. That's the best that I can say at this point in time.
Okay, we just have a couple more questions. We've overshot time by quite a bit, but just the last couple of questions. We have a question about mites or chiggers that are growing on plants, basically like red colored mites. Is there any way of stopping these? And also a question from Shamim on YouTube. He asks, he says he has a white cottony film and in the underside of his chili plants, which are tending to spread to other potted plants. How do you prevent these?
Okay. The mites, I'm not sure. You used two words. I wasn't sure what the second word is.
What he referred to as chiggers. CHIGGERS.
Okay, I'm not familiar with that word, but spider mites are a problem, and I don't know if that's what you have. Spider mites have a very fine webbing under the leaf, and they can be pretty destructive. If it's a big plant, I would say a neem oil spray usually is helpful. You can even do things like Bavaria Bassania, but if that's difficult to get at this point, you could go to any chemist and they'll have neem oil that's available. You know, it's added to hair oil for lice or whatever. So just take pure neem oil, dilute it 5 ml to a liter of water, but first dilute it in a soap solution, otherwise it will not mix with water. That should help with spider mites, if these are the same things that you're talking about. But if you send us a photo on Telegram and on the Telegram app, we should be able to identify it and get back to you with a more specific solution. The next question was about
It was from Shamim. Yes, he says he has a white film growing.
Yes. It could be most likely mealybug. And again, check, what is the plant? What are the ideal conditions that this plant likes? Is there too much humidity? Are you overfeeding your plants? Is there not enough sunlight? Check on that. Mealybugs can be dislodged. They don't have wings, so they can be dislodged with a jet spray. They are less likely to come back. Or a neem spray, that would also help. Bavaria Bassania, which I mentioned, that would also help. Most likely, it sounds like it is what's known as woolly aphids, or mealybugs are called woolly aphids. They look like this little fluffy, cottony kind of thing, usually found on the underside of leaves, and chili is prone to it. So make sure it's getting enough sunlight. That should sort of be one of the things you should troubleshoot about, that is sunlight sufficient or not.
Okay, so we have a few other questions, but I think they're mostly repeats of topics that we've already dealt with. I suggest all these people to ask these questions in the Telegram group. The link to the Telegram group is posted on the slide. You can see the slide here. It's t.me/anyonecangrow. So feel free to post photographs and ask your questions on this channel. And Karan and Yogita will be happy to answer them. That's it for the questions. Thanks, Karan. Thanks, Yogita. It was a very interesting session. And
so I think there's one more poll that we'd like, Amok to run, which is about how people have found the session, how useful have they found it. It would be great to have your feedback and get a sense of whether this has been productive to you. As I said, there are a few resources that we will post. There is a Excel sheet, or a table that we've created, which, you know, helps you kind of identify the different kinds of problems and make sure that you find solutions for them. Okay, so while we wait, I'd just like to mention that you can find a lot of, we are hoping that you can find a lot of seeds at the vegetable seeds at the seedstore.in. We do have a lot of seeds there, but it really depends on how couriers open up over the next couple of weeks. I think it may depend on, you know, access in each different city. It may be a little different from what we hear. Bombay may be not so easy for a little while, but perhaps Bangalore will be a little easier. Just have a look, see if you find something interesting to grow, and we'd be happy to provide that to you. If you're looking for more advice, more involved advice on, you know, what you can do in your garden, you know, get in touch with me. My number's here, and we've also given you our email address, which is info@greenessentials.in. So I'm sorry if things went suddenly dark. We seem to have lost power at exactly the right time. So thank you so much for joining us. Thanks again, Anish. Thanks, Amog. Thanks, Zainab, for all the help in organizing this and making sure that it runs smoothly. I'm really grateful that you folks have made the time to, you know, join, and I look forward to seeing you next week. That's on the 7th, I think, of May, again, a Thursday, for the last part of this session. Join us on Telegram if you'd like to know something before then. Bye from Yogita and me in Goa.